looking back.
Good morning and welcome to St Andrew's Cathedral. It's a state funeral, but it's really a national event. The kid from Nunnanulla Creek, just outside of Kempsey in northern New South Wales. He was born David Gordon Kirkpatrick, but he changed his name early on to Slim Dusty. Slim, he said, because that sounded country. And Dusty, he once told me, because he said that was about as Australian as the blowfly. The rest is pretty much music history and Australian history. Over 60 years, he sang and he sold over 6 million records. He won more golden guitars, more love, and more awards than just about anybody else. But he remained Slim Dusty. It was funny, you know. He was a fair-dinkum bloke with his moleskins and his R.M. William boots and that trademark Akubra hat that was turned down at the front here. He looked like a bush who'd come in for the Royal Sydney Easter Show. But he said when he put his hat on, that he was on duty, that he went to work, the hat and the old guitar. Well, they've come here today in their thousands, from the Prime Minister right through to busloads who've come from Tamworth this morning, and we're told even some from the Northern Territory. They've come here to pay tribute to this bloke, a state funeral that they don't give to many people. Very few, in fact. The first one was 1922 with Henry Lawson, and that would have pleased Slim because he loved Lawson, he loved Patterson. He felt he was carrying on their tradition. Joy Keane, the wife of 52 years, his beloved wife, and his close family and friends are here today. And some of those stars that he inspired, like Lee Kernaghan, is going to sing, and Troy Cassidaly, and Casey Chambers, and Graham Connors. Dick Smith, an old mate, is going to remember him, along with Peter Garrett and John Williamson, and his two children, Anne and David, will say something as well. Slim Dusty's song line stretches from the cathedral here all the way in the outback to Cunnamulla and beyond that. He was loved by the Aborigines and he spent a lot of time with them as well. They'll be watching today on Imparja and Channel 9 and on the ABC, in crossroads and corners and country towns and in cities and small places, all those places that he went and played. They'll remember a thousand bush ballads about the dreams and the fears and the fun that Australians had. He may have died and gone to heaven last Friday, but they can't stop the music and they can't stop the memories of Slim Dusty. There was one clever headline last week that said, Slim Dusty, the man with no peer. There'll be nothing morbid, nothing lonesome or drear about the ceremony today. It's meant to be a celebration of a very fortunate life.
Beautiful old cathedral, the oldest cathedral in Australia. Lots of familiar faces, politicians and music stars, radio and television personalities. It's a sad day, but it's the family have asked for a celebration, a recognition of this fortunate life. There we go. It's the most marvellous $12 million worth of refurbishment renovation they've done for the St Andrew's Cathedral. And this is the first major event since they've done that. The family will...
We welcome you to St Andrew's Cathedral today for the state funeral and the service of thanksgiving for the life of Slim Dusty. In particular, we welcome the representative of the Governor-General, Commander John Shevlin, the representative of the Governor of New South Wales, Sir Nicholas Shahady, the Acting Premier, the Honourable Dr. Andrew Refshaughey, the Prime Minister, the Honourable John Howard, and the Leader of the Opposition, the Honourable Simon Crean. We acknowledge the traditional owners of this land, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation. We welcome friends and family of Slim Dusty, those inside the cathedral, and those many who are outside the cathedral, those who are listening to us by radio and watching us by television around the world. Would you please remain seated as Joy and David and Anne and the family enter, bringing with them Slim's medals of public recognition.
Three cushions by the grandchildren, being carried by the grandchildren. The Order of Australia by Jane Kirkpatrick, who is Slim's daughter-in-law. The MBE on another cushion was granted to Slim back in the 1970s. And the Australia Post solid gold replica series of stamps that he was especially proud of, along with one of Slim's golden guitars from Tamworth. The first one he won was back in 1973, an extraordinary 36 since then. No musician has come anywhere near that.
So they'll be placed alongside the coffin before the procedure begins. The welcome was from Philip Jensen, who's the Dean of Sydney. Six members of the travelling country band, Slim's band, who three or four of them played with him for 25 years or more, so they've been everywhere with this travelling man. Outside in Sydney Square and St Andrew's Square, they expected perhaps 2,000 people, even spilling out as the service goes on out onto George Street. Lots of Akubra hats here today, let me tell you. The Order of Australia, the MBE, the Golden Guitar. Introduction from Chris Moroney, who's the senior minister at the cathedral.
We extend our sympathy to Joy, to David, to Anne, and to every member of the family. Thousands of people have gathered here today. It's a great tribute to Slim. Around the nation, many people share your sorrow and seek to support you on this special occasion. We come together today to honour a departed friend. We come together today to dispose reverently of the mortal body and to show sympathy with the bereaved. At this time, we recall the certainty of our own coming death and judgment and proclaim that Christ is risen, and that those who believe in him will rise with him, and that we can be united with them through faith in Jesus Christ. Hear the words of encouragement from the scriptures. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd. He will guide them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble." As we remain standing, let us join in this prayer together. Heavenly Father, in your Son, Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Help us to live as those who believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life. Through Son Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Both here and outside in Sydney Square, and of course in the nation as a whole, all have our own particular memories and wish to bring our own particular tributes to Slim. The very size of our nation coming together at this point in time is indicative of how important this man has been to us. We've asked three prominent Australians to lead us in giving tribute. Just for a few minutes each, and they're of course under terrible restriction of time because of that, but they're going to speak to us each one in a few moments' time. Before that, we're going to have a family tribute because that's even more important, but before that, I wonder if you just spend a moment thinking of the thing about Slim that was most important to you, your memory, the thing you would say as a tribute if you had a chance to say it. Then we'll take just 1 minute and tell the person beside us about it. Please, share your tribute with the person beside you. Feel free. He was every man's man, wasn't he? 1999, Father of the Year. And so, of course, the most important tributes come from our two friends, David and Anne. And David, if you would.
Slim Dusty, born David Gordon Kirkpatrick, on Friday the 13th to a very superstitious Irish father, 1927, Kempsey, New South Wales. Boy from the bush, he travelled from Nulla Creek to the furthest reaches of this land. He journeyed into the heart and soul of Australia and all its people. His story is well known to all of us, and I'm not going to repeat it from birth to journey's end. Many more eloquent speakers than I will eulogise Slim for many, many years to come. His place in Australian folklore is indisputably clear. I want to briefly share with you some of the things that I feel made him special to me and my family. To Joy, his wife and soulmate of 52 years. To his adoring and his adored daughter Anne. To his daughter-in-law Jane, who held a special place in his heart. And to Greg, his son-in-law, with whom he could always have a yarn. And of course, to his cherished grandchildren, Kate, James, Daniel, and Hannah. He will be forever simply Pa in their hearts. Slim was a man who lived his life by simple principles, and he taught me by example. Foremost of all, he was genuine and honest. You have to be fair dinkum, he would say. People can pick you if you're not sincere. His passion for his music and the stories he told of Australians and their way of life was all-consuming. To see him with his guitar, whether it be in his caravan, motel room, at Metung, looking over Chinaman's Creek across Bancroft Bay, or at home in his studio den in Sydney, was to see him at his most relaxed and free. When he was on stage, you felt like he was speaking to you personally, inviting you to become part of his dream. I could only look on in wonder at his stamina and drive, but it was inconceivable that he'd be doing anything else. What you saw on stage and what you heard on record was how he was, a genuine Australian bloke. Slim was so fortunate to have found a life partner who shared his vision and passion. I know that Slim would want me to acknowledge the key role that his wife Joy played in his life. She was, quite simply, the bedrock on which he centered his existence. She helped channel his dreams into reality. She was utterly devoted to him. She sustained him with her love all his life. And in those last few hard months, that love and commitment eased his passage until he was ready to leave. He never took fame for granted. He never looked on it as something he deserved or owned. In fact, I don't think he ever quite believed all the accolades that came his way or what the fuss was all about. Has this travel in life of mine really happened? Have I sung so many songs and been so far, he wrote. But he never forgot that his fans were the reason he was able to continue doing what he loved, what he had to do. His fans were his first consideration in everything he did. He never stopped touring because people still wanted to see him sing. The other enduring principle that Slim lived by was mateship. From his earliest days in Nulla, roaming the bush with his childhood friends, to those wonderful, exciting years of travelling around Australia with his show, Slim loved his mates. He was never happier than being with his band and crew, who were his closest friends. On the road, he would catch up each year with his mates around Australia, share a cup of tea, or more likely a beer with them, swapping stories and yarns. It seems like all Australia felt they were his mate. People felt they could speak to Slim, that he was one of them. Our family has been so very touched and uplifted by the outpouring of affection for Slim from the community. We all feel we've lost a mate, and there's a space that can't be filled. He was unique. There will never be another like him. As his son, I loved him for his mateship, his integrity, and his spirit. I loved him as my dad. There was a farewell that Slim would often use to close his shows, and so on Slim's behalf, I'd like to say to all Australians for one last time, goodbye, God bless, and many happy campfires.
I wanted to say a few words for Dad. He wouldn't want me to get too flowery, but to get on with it, to keep moving on as he did to the next town, to the next tour, to the next album. He was someone with incredible momentum and energy, and it was infectious to all around him. Obviously, I wanted my dad to be here always. We shared a great closeness that I know I'll never replace. But I draw great comfort knowing that he led the life that he wanted to a T. And from knowing how lucky I am to have spent so much time on the road with Dad touring over the years. He loved nothing better than to be on the road somewhere in Australia heading for the next town, looking forward to the show that night, to singing and meeting the people and probably to have a few beers afterwards with everyone. But I'll miss his cheeky irreverence. He didn't always do or say the correct thing, which caused Mother some consternation at times, but mostly it made us smile. I'll miss singing with him, and I'll just miss him. I'm immensely proud of his pioneering spirit and what he has achieved. The list of awards and accolades is astonishing enough, but as importantly to me in the overall picture of this travelling life that he has led, I have seen firsthand on tour and from the letters that arrive at the office and the replies that go out, just how Dad's music has touched so many lives and made a difference. Stories of children soothed to sleep with Slim Dusty songs, a truckie buried with his favourite Slim Dusty recording, Dad's music requested and played at all manner of family occasions, a message of encouragement recorded and sent to a desperately ill fan in hospital or to visit them on the road, and so it goes. Due to his illness, Dad found it increasingly hard to concentrate for lengths of time. But two things I saw that did hold his interest in later weeks, they say a lot about him. Firstly, a video, The Last Ride of Tex Morton, was a documentary on Tex's life. And then there was Lawson. One afternoon I was flipping through a volume of Henry Lawson's works, and it opened at a poem, Jack Dunn of Never Tire. Well, it was a long poem, and Dad sat and listened intently as I read it right through to the very end. And when I'd finished, we both just sat there quietly and agreed, yeah, Lawson was the best. His musical influences may have been the likes of Jimmy Rogers and Tex Morton, but it was the spirit and the writings of Lawson from which he drew constant inspiration. In that tradition, there's a Norma Murphy song Dad recorded that's always stuck in my mind, and I'd like to leave you with some lines from it. So, you'll have to look for him much further out, for he's seen fire and flood and he's seen drought, and he knows what this wide brown land's about. Yes, you'll have to look for him much further out. Travel well, Dad.
always your DD.
Travelling Still Always Will, written by Anne Kirkpatrick about a mum and dad.
As the Dean of the Cathedral, can I encourage us to follow the example of our friends outside and feel free?
Yes. Thank you for that. Wonderful. It's terrific.
Wisdom is found in all kinds of places. One of the more famous of our Australian friends who's with us is Peter Garrett. He's going to come and speak to us now about Slim and his relationship with this world, with the land, and with the Indigenous peoples of the land. Peter, if you would come.
What can we say about Slim as we mourn and commemorate his passing? Well, Slim Dusty was a pioneer, poet, and an ever-present performer rolled all into one. An unassuming giant amongst us, plain in speech, humble and fair in character. Slim's life is an extraordinary achievement, which we mark today for this bloke who crisscrossed the country from coast to coast, from generation to generation, never flagged. He never lost touch with his audience, and Slim always came back. Slim was that rarest of performers whose gift was to yarn to everyone in song. He was having a conversation in an Australian accent, free of prejudice and vanity. These, the best parts of our character, were found in Slim Dusty, the singer and songwriter. Seemingly tireless, and as timeless as the vast stretches of arid landscape, desert and mountains he toiled across year in and year out, Slim was somehow in sync with the times as well. Like all masters of performance, he was able to always rise to the occasion. After all, he'd done it so many times in the dusty showgrounds, the raw rodeos, the remote towns, the cities, the clubs, the creek beds, on flat-top trucks, in school of arts halls. From the Opera House down, I doubt there's one place Slim missed on his great Australian odyssey. I first saw Slim perform on Countdown, the Australian pop program in the early 70s. Surrounded by the gaudy glitter and screaming girls, he effortlessly did his Slim thing. An ageless country guy with a hat and guitar, overcoming live pop TV in a single bound. He made it look easy, and he also made it real. And that's no mean feat. Of course, I'd heard his songs before. After all, they're deep-rooted in the Australian psyche, just as Slim himself was. You didn't have to know much about country music to know about Slim Dusty. And Slim didn't come from the wrong side of the tracks. Where Slim came from, there were no tracks at all. Over a lifetime, he made the road, the life support system for any performer of any kind of music, his domain. As Bush Troubadour Slim, with dozens of bands, musicians and support acts, some he championed who were destined to become famous in their own right, he ran the marathon of music 1,000 times over. Yes, he had a terrific partnership with his wife Joy. He had fine musicians to play with, and he had his ever loyal public who were as central to Slim's career as Slim himself. They kept him alive in the lean times and introduced their kids to his songs. Still, at the end, Slim Dusty was as good, if not better, than the day he started. Given the hundreds of albums, thousands of shows, millions of songs sung and miles driven, that is truly remarkable. Preparing for today, I was thinking that Slim reminded me of a lean, old, massive ghost gum spared the axe. When we saw and listened to him, he made us feel truly at home. He was giving off something uniquely Australian. He wasn't trying to impress. He was just being fair dinkum, taking everyone as he found them, young and old, town and country, white, black, and in between. I want to read part of a statement from Mundawoi Yunupingu from Eastern Arnhem Land, who couldn't be present today. Mundawoy writes, "To my mate, memories of you and your songs will live on in the hearts and minds of our people. You were the first pioneer of reconciliation between black and white Australia. The message in your songs brings harmony and balance between people and the land. You were an inspiration and a big influence when I was growing up in the bush. My family adopted you into our family and gave you a skin identity, Malku, male red kangaroo. This was in recognition of you being part of what Aboriginal people sing about in describing our Australia. We've learnt from you. You gave us so much back, friendship and the will to survive. Like Mundawoy, I came to know Slim and Joy, and I appreciated their concern for the country, its people and its precious environment. Just as I marvelled at the fact that they were making music and writing songs, engaging in life like there was no tomorrow. And so to Joy, David, Anne and your clan, Mundawoy's and my family would like to join hands with you to farewell a hero. With everyone here in this church and all those listening and watching around our country, to a great Australian and hero of the Outback, we bid you farewell as you embark on your journey on the Road of Songs. 6 months on the Road of Songs, I'm saddle weary now, gonna wipe the dust from a face and the cobweb from a brow. But to save the talk, must be on my way. And leave your town alone. Oh, it's very important now, you know, because I'm just going home. Farewell, Slim."
Peter Garrett there. Troy Cassidaly and Casey Chambers recorded Walk a Country Mile. They sang it at the Country Music Awards just last year. They were asked by the family to sing again today, Walk a Country Mile.
Miles, I still
Eric Asadale and Casey Chambers with Walker Country Mile. Slim passed the baton with the Country Music Association of Australia on to John Williams.
Terrific. It's so hard to sing at a funeral of a friend, but beautiful. John Williamson's a great singer for us. He's going to come to us now and share about Slim and his music and the great contribution of music to this land. Thank you, John.
Naturally, I'll be underlining things that have already been said, but Slim Dusty was truly an Australian legend, and he was a pioneer, and will be sorely missed by Australia's country music mob and his mountain of fans. To many people, he was part of the family, and his passing will leave a vacuum in homes all around the country. And he's been an inspiration, as you've just seen, to young artists who grew up with his music and had the privilege to record or sing with him, or indeed write songs for him. Personally, I borrowed many feathers from his hat. His success showed me that we do want to hear songs about us, and he proved you can make a career out of music, singing like an Aussie. I remember Joy and Slim telling me that they used to hide their records under a rock rather than admit that they were Slim Dusty fans. This is a way back. But at last we have come of an age and we recognise who we really are, and Slim is who we are. Easygoing, fair-dinkum, and friendly, and deep down, really proud of Australia and things Australian. With Buddy Williams, Stan Coster, and now the King of Country Music gone, it is nearing the end of an era in Australian folklore, a time when men were recognised by the bash in their hats. And isn't it great to see so many Slim bashed hats out there in the crowd outside the cathedral today? Slim was the voice that kept the link between banjo and Henry Lawson and us. He was the star that our bush ballad writers could sing through. He was the keeper of the flame that crackled on a Gidgee campfire. He sailed through the rock and roll era that nearly stole our identity. And when we sing Waltzing Matilda, we'll think of Slim around the campfire, outside the caravan that brought country music over gravel and dirt roads to all bush Australians. He was God to itinerant workers and truckies. He was God in Aboriginal settlements. And it's fitting that he was recording right to the very end, and I guess that was always going to be the case. He would be halfway through an album when he passed. His competitive nature came from the old days, from the in-your-face battle between tents at the showgrounds, where success was measured by drawing a bigger crowd than the tent down the line. Slim showed us the strength of a simple Aussie ballad, no frills, as pure and as straight to the point as the characters he sang about. A style that must never be lost. It is the essence, the foundation that holds Australian country music together. And to his wife, Joy McKean, the woman behind him, you will always be the tower that supported the icon. And I hope you continue to write great songs like Lights on the Hill, for you too are an icon to be recognised, and any monument erected to Slim should have one of you beside him. My heart is most heavy for you and David and your family. And all I can say is happy campfires back to you, Slim, and thank God for Slim Dusty. And it's now fitting that we now listen to a Henry Lawson song that was Joy's favourite, and Slim put the music to it, and it's called Do You Think That I Do Not.
final of our formal tributes will come from that Australian that we know who's going to speak of Slim and his contribution to Australia. That is our friend Dick Smith. Immediately after Dick has spoken to us, come forward, Dick. Major Chris Witt from the Salvation Army will be reading for us Psalm 23 as we have written before us. Thank you, Dick.
Thank you. Slim Dusty, of course, was intensely proud to be an Australian. Slim loved our beautiful land, especially the outback. Slim represented the spirit of Australia. He once said to me, "Dick, this land gives opportunity to everybody, and if we could only all pull together, we'll be a great nation one day." If you're asked to describe a real Australian, you would describe Slim Dusty, down to earth, a straight talker. He had our unique Aussie accent, a downturned hat to keep out the sun, a rugged, sunburnt country complexion, and a quiet demeanour. He was a kind person, generous, and had a good sense of humour. He once flew with me in atrocious weather over the rugged Blue Mountains to give a surprise birthday to a sick mountain cattleman. I remember Slim saying, "Dick, if we crash, we can eat the birthday cake." Slim was loved by all Australians. Once in Birdsville, I followed Slim down the main street as a group of Aboriginal kids held onto his coat tails and walked along. He was their hero. Slim was as Australian as you can get. Slim would have known that Prince Harry was going to a sheep station, not a sheep farm, and that we don't have truckers, we have truckies. And by the way, the truckies will be listening today in silence. This state funeral is on Pardew TV through Outback Australia. Aboriginal communities will be watching, and all of those in the Outback. Now, Slim was a modest person. A few months ago, I called at his house in Sydney's North Shore. The house is typically suburban, nothing big or flashy. The front door was open, of course, so I walked in, and Joy took me to where Slim was playing a CD. Yes, it was one of his. Slim looked very ill, but we didn't mention that. We had a cup of tea and waddled out back where Slim and Joy had built a flat for Auntie Una, who had travelled with them on the road for years. Upstairs were a couple of small rooms where daughter Anne and assistant Leslie worked in answering thousands of letters that came in, sometimes sending in lyrics and music, sometimes asking for advice. Slim did everything he could to help as many as possible. We then walked downstairs, past the vegetable garden and the chooks, and over to Slim's garage. Hidden on the side were some stairs, which went up to a recording studio that some would describe as Heath Robinson in construction. Slim sat down, got out his guitar, and grabbed a few bits of paper of some of the recent lyrics that had been sent in. I sat there for an hour, mesmerized. I thought, this is like sitting with Banjo Patterson or with Henry Lawson. Everything he sang was inspirational. I wish I'd had a tape recorder with me. Slim strongly supported our campaign for Aussie farmers and a fairer balance in Australian ownership and keeping our own identity in this globalised world. One of his songs was very supportive. Let me read a few lines. "I speak for the nation whenever I say, you can't take Australia from me. You can program the TV and fill up our papers with things you'd like us to be, but you can't take away what's deep in my heart. No, you can't take Australia from me." And I'm also reminded of one of my favourite Slim songs. The words say, I'd sooner be a has-been than a never was at all. All my life I had a go, I really had a ball. If you don't climb the ladder, mate, you can never fall. I'd sooner been a has-been than a never was at all. Slim, you will never be a has-been and you'll never be a never was at all. In 50 years, you will be revered as Banjo Patterson, Henry Lawson are today. Slim, we honour you. Thank you.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures, and he leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul, he leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Amazing Grace. Graham Connors is going to come and lead the singing of this hymn. Graham, I understand, is going to sing the first verse himself and then invite us to stand after the first verse and join with him in verses 2 and 3.
Beautiful voice there of Graham Connor, who wrote a dozen songs for Slim.
It's a great privilege to welcome the Reverend Bill Cruz from the Exodus Foundation to read to us from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 26.
Rest in peace, Slim. All Australia loves you. A reading from Matthew. Now, as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing, broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new with you and in my Father's kingdom." And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them, "You will all fall away because of me this night, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd and the sheep of the flock will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee." Peter answered him, "Though they all fall away because of you, I will never fall away." Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, this very night, before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. Peter said to him, "Even if I must die with you, I will not deny you." And all the disciples said the same.
Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." And taking with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch with me." And going a little further, he fell on his face and prayed, saying, "My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." And may the Lord give his blessing to this reading.
Heavenly Father, we do indeed ask for your blessing upon this reading, that understanding your word, we might know how to live in the face of death. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, on behalf of all who are gathered here at St. Andrew's Cathedral, both inside and outside, and on behalf of the hundreds of thousands who are listening to this broadcast or watching it on TV, in fact, as a state funeral, on behalf of the entire nation, I would like to express our sympathy to Joy and to David and to Anne and to the family. You have shared your husband, your father, your grandfather with us for many years. And we want you to know how much we appreciated having Slim and how sorrowful we are for our loss and how sorrowful we are for yours. Death is a dreadful thing. It robs us of our mates. And Slim was not only the Father of the Year and the first Senior Citizen of the Year, an Officer of the Order of Australia, a member of the British Empire, a winner of innumerable awards. Slim was, for all of us, that quintessential mate. Each of our tributes, I think, contributed to that point. It is such a distinctively Australian virtue, mateship. And he was our mate. But there are two things that destroy mateship. Two things which are common to us all, each and every one. Sin and death. For we all do wrong things sometimes, even to our mates. And that wrecks mateship. And we all need forgiveness. And sometimes the price of forgiveness is too high for us to pay. And reconciliation becomes impossible. And we all, each one of us, face death. The death of our mates and our own death. And death always robs us of our mates. Now, at this time, we are walking in what Psalm 23 calls the shadow of the valley of the shadow of death. For we have lost our mate, and it's a sad day for the whole nation. Slim's songs often captured the sorrow and loneliness of death, and more commonly, I think, the pleasure of mateship. I think of his two biggest hits. We won't have a little test to find out which ones you're thinking of. I think it's well known. The two biggest ones, well, they're both about mateship. I love to have a beer with Duncan because Duncan's me mate. That's what it's about, isn't it? And of course, the biggest of all time was a pub with no beer. There's nothing so lonesome, morbid or drear to stand in the bar of a pub with no beer. Friends, I'm no drinking man, and I'm not much of a singer either. But I don't think we can have Slim Dusty's funeral without singing just one verse of A Pub With No Beer. It just wouldn't be a funeral of Slim Dusty, would it? They think so. And you guys have to cover my voice. Are we ready? Oh, it's a lonesome away from your kindred and all. By the campfire that's not, we'll hear the wild dingoes call. But there's nothing so lonesome, morbid or drear, than to stand in the bar of a pub with no beer. Yeah, we couldn't do it. Like Duncan, A Pub With No Beer is about mateship. The friendship of drinking together as equals, contrasted with the misery of loneliness. The song's not about alcohol. If you remember the words down in the verses, you'll see one of them, it's still the, there is wine for the wine buff, isn't there? But there's no beer because there's no, the ordinary bloke's drink is missing. The stockman, the swaggy, the blacksmith, the maid. The drink of beer is symbolic of enjoying mateship at the end of our journey, at the end of a hard day's work. You see, in some ways, Slim and Jesus were alike. Both were rural storytellers, travelling tirelessly from town to town, from little villages amongst the ordinary people, the little people of their day, telling their stories, encountering life as it is, out amongst the people. I mean, both were famous in their day. The first century Jewish historian records for us about Jesus, Josephus writes of him. And yet, like Slim, famous he may have been, he was one of the little people. Jesus didn't have a story about a pub with no beer, but he once did go to a wedding without wine. And there, to the amazement of all, he saved the party by turning the water that was set aside for ceremonial washing into the finest quality wine. That is said to be the first sign showing his glory or greatness. But frankly, it doesn't make much sense, does it? I mean, what kind of glory, what kind of greatness is it is to turn water into wine? I know I can't do it, and I guess you can't either, but what does it mean? Has he just come to do miracles? Is all that it shows? Did God become man in order to do party tricks? In order to show off his power? In order to save a wedding from embarrassment? Hardly. No, there's more to that sign than that. It's about turning the water of religious ceremonial washing into the reality and joy of true cleansing and new life. Not just washing us externally ceremonially, but forgiving us properly and truly, dealing with death by giving life. But you won't understand the first of the signs of Jesus until you study the last of the signs of Jesus, which Bill read to us just a few moments ago from the end of Matthew's Gospel. For there we read, it's printed in front of you if you have that program, he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." Now, this cup of wine that he is handing around does not symbolize fun and pleasure. Not like the wedding. This cup of red wine symbolized his blood, or more accurately, his blood shed in violent sacrificial death, poured out for many. His blood in which was written the new covenant, it means contract, between God and man, the contract of forgiveness that we all need. Forgiveness because a restitution for sin was being paid by his bloodshed. Paid not by us, but by the only man who could pay the price, the innocent man, who was God, the offended party. And he didn't want to drink the cup of his father's wrath. He didn't want to drink it down to those bitter dregs of death. But he was willing to drink it for us, that we may be forgiven. For notice the last little part that Bill was reading to us there. My Father, he prayed, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Not as I will, but as you will. And so, in a single action of his death, he dealt with the two things that wreck mateship, both sin and death. Sin because his perfect sacrifice paid for our sin, and death because not death is no longer the end but the beginning. 3 days later he rose again from the grave and appeared to many witnesses. And notice what he promised. For he says back there in verse 29, it's about the third or fourth paragraph there in that reading, I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. After his death has dealt with sin, then he would drink again. But then drinking would symbolize mateship and friendship and joy and happiness and restored relationships, permanent relationships, restored because sin is dealt with, permanent because death has been dealt with. And so then it will be the time of party and of fun, of drinking anew in the kingdom of God, drinking with God in his kingdom. Heaven, my friends, is not a pub without beer. Hell is the pub with neither beer nor mates to share it with. But for the party of heaven to be established, sin has to be dealt with, death has to be dealt with, which is what Jesus did in drinking the cup of God's wrath in his execution, as he cried out those terrible words of dereliction, my God, why have you forsaken me? King David was a country boy. He was a shepherd who became a king. He knew what it was like to go through the valley of the shadow of death. But he did not fear evil. Why? Because the Lord was his shepherd. We walk this day through the valley of the shadow of death. Here today, around the coffin of our mate, we are brought again face to face with a death that there's not a person in Australia would want. And we're reminded once again that our day comes too. Do not ask for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. David knew that the Lord was his shepherd, the good shepherd, who laid down his life for the sheep. Is the Lord your shepherd? Can you say with David, the Lord is my shepherd? He is the shepherd who loved his sheep enough to lay down for them. But the question remains, is he my shepherd? One of Slim's songs went, my clothes may be old and look ragged as I lie neath the scars by the bend. As I dream, there is one consolation. I have a king for a friend. But he's just the one who made the mountains.
He's just the one who lights the stars. He's just the one who sends the sunshine. He's just the one who made the flowers. He's just the one who hangs the rainbows. He's just the one who placed the pearls. He's just the King of Kings in heaven. He's just the one who made the world. Oh, I'm tired and I'm weary from roaming. And this dusty road, it never seems to end. But I wouldn't want to go on living if I didn't have a king for a friend. Is the Lord your shepherd? Is the King your friend?
That address by Dean Philip Jensen from the Cathedral.
Friends, we come to sing again. We sing of the old rugged cross upon which our Lord Jesus was crucified. This is a song, a hymn that was written in 1913, a song that was recorded by Slim on one of his first family albums. I'd like to introduce Lee Kernighan and James Gillard, who are going to be leading our singing, and invite you to stand with us as we sing together The Old Rugged Cross. Would you please be seated? We come to a time of prayer. Let us pray. Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Holy Mother, you gave us life when you created us, and in your redeeming love, you have given us new life in Jesus Christ. We give thanks today for our friend Slim Dusty. We thank you for his deep love of all people, for his generous personality, and for his wonderful music. In faith and trust, we leave him in your keeping. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who died and rose again to save us, and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit in glory forever. Amen. Almighty God, Father of all mercies and giver of all comfort, deal graciously, we pray, with those who mourn. We especially pray today for Slim's family, that casting all their care on you, they may know the consolation of your love through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, you alone are the source of life. May your life-giving spirit flow through us. Grant us your compassion, one for the other. In our sorrow, give us the calm of your peace. Kindle our hope, and let our grief give way to joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We started our tributes thinking privately and sharing with the person beside us, because Slim really was the man of all peoples. And so we finish our time of prayer in quietness. Let's spend a moment in reflecting upon Slim and his life, thanking God for him, reflecting upon joy in the family, and praying God's comfort for them, thinking about ourselves and our contribution to this great nation and our standing before our Maker. Let us spend a moment just in quiet reflection together.
Now may the peace of God our Father and his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, be with us this day, now and forevermore. Amen.
The blessing then from Philip Jensen, which ends this state funeral for Slim Dusty. The last song, Looking Forward, Looking Back, was his last great hit.
Well done.
Slim's hat on the coffin there with the Australian flag draped over it, the Australian wildflowers. The hat has a, for a band, has a plaited whip around it, and just one badge, the badge with the face of Henry Lawson on the old sundowner hat, the Akubra hat, that very much was Slim's trademark. The pallbearers for the coffin, this is his son David and the son-in-law Greg, grandsons James and Daniel, and Rod Coe, who was the bass guitar player and music director for Slim for 25 years, Mike Kerrin, the fiddle player and a very close friend. The six pallbearers for Slim's coffin.
Rise unto me, may the wind be always at your back.
A remarkable list of state funerals in the last 100 years in New South Wales. Henry Lawson, as I mentioned earlier, was the first to be given, granted, first distinguished citizen to be granted a state funeral. Professor Sir Edgeworth David, right through to Dame Mary Gilmore in 1962, Victor Chang in 1992, John Newman, the MP, murdered and given a funeral in 1994, and Charlie Mance, the last one, the World War I veteran, who was given a state funeral in 2001. But Slim is the first entertainer, the first one from show business to be given a state funeral. There were 850 people in the cathedral today, and the family were anxious that a great many of them were just fans, not personalities or stars or politicians or leaders, but just half of the 850 were people who were fans who just asked to be here and were let in and given pride of place. Just the way Slim would have liked it. Now, regards to people watching on Channel 9 right around the country and watching on Empowage as well, right through the centre, that footprint that takes in the real outback and right down to Kangaroo Island, we wish you well and hope that you've enjoyed this service today. The family were anxious that it should be a tribute and a celebration, a sad case, but nevertheless a celebration of a most remarkable man. I came out the western door of the cathedral to be escorted by the New South Wales Mounted Horse Brigade, a section of four old horses and country cops who will escort the form the cortege. Police chief was telling me in charge of this section yesterday that the last mounted policeman in New South Wales was at Bellbird, which is just up the road from Nullarnulla Creek, where of course Slim was born, and it seemed appropriate that they should be there and escorting the coffin as it heads off for the family service, which will be held shortly. Australian flag, Australian wildflowers, and Slim's Akubra hat. 5,000 more just on the other side in Sydney Square next to the Town Hall. All waited, and if you saw them, those wide shots when Slim and others were singing, they were all singing and clapping their hands along, so clearly they saw it. It's this festive occasion too, if you like. Sad but a great memorial to this great Australian. They're starting to leave a bit now, but they've been here for the hour and a half almost of this state funeral, state service for Slim Dusty. They're the four mounted horsemen, mounted policemen, bush cops, and old horses. They tell me that the older the horse for a mounted policeman, the better the horse. No thoroughbreds here, these are just bush ponies. And a final round of applause for Slim Dusty as the cortege moves off down Bathurst Street, led by the horses just in a slow march. In reverence, they'll get over George Street and then pick up to a trot and take them up to Hyde Park, and then the motorcycle police will escort the cortege out to the northern suburbs for the to the crematorium for the cremation of the later day, which is a closed family affair. Dean Philip Jensen, the Dean of the Cathedral, leading the cortege, and Chris Moroney, the Senior Minister.
Tonight here by the roadside, after driving hard all day, dreaming of the old folks and the homestead.
I hope you can hear it, the round of applause as the cortege goes by up to George Street.
I'll be there with the
just ordinary Aussies. Standing by and saying farewell to Slim Dusty.
I see the homestead cattle as around the place they roam. The old man with the horses on the fields of golden loam. And mother in the doorway just to make this.
We're honoured to have brought this to you today from wherever you are, in whatever crossroad or whatever country town and little corner of Australia where Slim went and sang. We're sure that you love to see this moment. Thanks for being with us.